Hi there, I'm nicodehaan, and welcome to Living a Primal Lifestyle, where we explore a return to a more balanced and natural wild world.
To recover our natural health and regain our rights and freedoms, and I'm Ellen DeHaan.
It's a beautiful day in Durango, Colorado, 37 degrees, going down to 13 tonight, and clear skies all around.
Yeah, snow on the ground, the winter is upon us.
Yeah, we had a flurry just a couple nights ago.
Well, it was a dump of a few inches of snow, but it's melting and... Yeah. That's all good.
And the trees are gorgeous.
Oh, it's just magical.
That's for sure.
And I dig out my boots and get the boxes down.
A couple of sweaters.
Yeah, a little bit of the winter clothes. Yeah.
Yeah. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel. Hit the notification bell and the like button to help our channel grow. We also post the show on Facebook and LinkedIn for your convenience. We deconstruct mainstream news stories about anti-aging, natural health, climate, and our freedom. And do our own analysis, and you should too. All topics for today's show are in the show notes listed below in the description, so you can follow along and do that research that you need to do. Now, if you supplement your diet with natural vitamins and minerals, then we highly recommend Mother Earth Labs. Hit the link below the show notes and maximize your nutrition with their products, Humic and Fulvic, and essential multivitamins. These two formulas, which we take, give you all the essential vitamins, minerals, and amino acids required for a healthy immune system, with the ability for your body to access them and to detox at the same time. They also make great selection of other things that you may be interested in. So we should get this party started here. So the first link we have here is alt meat fever has cooled, and here's why. So we've heard a lot about these plant-based meats.
Yeah, we've been talking about it for months and months, really.
Yeah, heralded by many as the death knell to big meat. It appears at this moment to have dealt only a flesh wound, it says here.
Yeah, the promise of high-tech meat substitutes prompted a frenzy of celebrity investment, red-hot IPOs in 2019. However, and a lot of the big meat companies jumped on the bandwagon, including Tyson, Smithfield, Purdue, Hormel, and Nestle. But, and then, you know, at the time in 2019, the analysts were writing about the hunger for meat, dairy, and egg substitutes.
Yeah. Okay, they call them flexitarians. Mm-hmm. Non-vegetarians looking for easy swaps to do less harm to the environment, the animals, and their health. Executive poured in from all different food companies to get jobs in this industry. Fast food giants added plant-based offerings with much fanfare.
Yeah, but then things slowed down.
Yeah.
And the meteoric growth in 2020 flattened out in 2021. Retail sales have dropped more than 10% in the past year. Beyond Meat, which is a Los Angeles-based purveyor of plant-based burgers, crumbles, nuggets, and such, saw its stock prices plunge nearly 80% from its peak.
Wow.
And last month, the company announced it would lay off about 19% of its workforce.
Yeah, it's not just Beyond Meat. The meat giant JBSSA announced in early October it was shuttering its two-year-old Plantera business in the United States, and closing its 190,000-square-foot Colorado facility. And McDonald's also tabled its idea to roll out McPlant burger nationally. That doesn't even sound yummy.
Oh, none of it does. Yeah, not very appetizing. The Stockholm Environment Institute recently issued a report that found that the production of animal-based foods responsible for as much as 20% of total gas emissions, greenhouse gas emissions, but the report also there's a lot of negativity around meat, right? So they said if meat consumption continues, it will be impossible to keep global warming below the goal of 1.5 degrees Celsius. And they also found that animal-based food systems were a key driver of biodiversity loss. Of course, every however many thousand years, with all the different cycles that go on, the gas emissions were higher.
Well, a lot of times, sure, volcanoes can do that by themselves,
well, of course.
Sure, and then methane when the Arctic melts, naturally. There's
it releases.
Nothing. Mm-hmm. But I think the big thing is that people just don't have a taste for these things. They're highly processed food, first of all.
Right.
So even though it sounds like a good idea for people who are concerned about animal health, you know, there are a lot of options you can buy from purveyors that treat their animals really well.
Yeah.
And slaughter them very humanely.
Right. So that's, sure. Well, they have five reasons here for why the market has cooled. Start with price. And they say that one of the reasons that beef was an attractive place to start for the new plant-based meat companies because beef is expensive. But it turned out that the plant-based beef is twice as expensive as conventional beef. And plant-based chicken is four times as expensive as conventional chicken.
Yeah, and they thought, of course, as time goes on and they get better at this, that it would get cheaper and cheaper. That really hasn't happened yet.
Mm-mm.
Plant-based beef is still twice as expensive as conventional beef.
That's
what you said.
Yeah. So then the next reason they mentioned is fuzzy health benefits.
Yeah, the first generation of simulated meat.
Tofurkey.
Yeah, all these Boca burgers, things like that. Now, mm-hmm. Boca burgers have been around for
a long
20, 30
time.
Years, probably.
Oh, yeah. More than that, probably.
Yeah, they were designed for folks who didn't eat meat and consumers. The next generation, which more closely mimics meat in texture, and many products bleed like real beef. Well, that's...
Yeah.
I don't know if you'd want that. And the flavor was for flexitarians... they aimed to,
reduce their meat consumption.
Yeah, frequency. So the flavor was a little bit better, they said.
Right, and texture. But once the novelty went away, the consumer started to read the label. Meat has one ingredient. And now you're looking at products with 15 ingredients. And people started saying, well, what the heck is methylcellulose? And why am I paying a premium for it?
Yeah. So, conventional meat has also become synonymous with protein, and protein is, for many people, something that you can't get too much of.
Mm-hmm. Most meat substitutes are lower in saturated fat than conventional meat, making them better for you in that regard. Well, that's a debatable.
Yeah, that's debatable because right. We like fat.
Yeah, animal fat is the natural animal fat. It's important, as a matter of fact. But manufacturers are trying to address skepticism about the high level of processing.
Yeah.
By developing new products that limit unnecessary ingredients and chemicals and fortifying them with vitamins, minerals, and other micronutrients, all of which are naturally occurring in the meat.
That's right.
And they don't need to add.
Right, and they're not using those natural occurring vitamins and minerals. They're using a substitute type, which is manufactured.
Yes.
So that's not good either.
That's not good either. All right, next reason is restaurants are not buying in.
Or too many players is before that. I didn't highlight that.
Okay.
But there's too much competition. It's also crowded, and no one expected all these brands to be there in 10 years. And certainly that's not happening, for sure.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Restaurants are not buying in?
Yeah. Independent restaurants were the first to sell some of these new generation of plant-based burgers. But to thrive, they must work for fast food, where billions of burgers are sold annually. So Burger King saw success with its Impossible Whopper, a dead ringer for the real thing, only a little squishier. But the other food chains didn't seem to be as fortunate.
Yeah, and they said that McDonald's launched its McPlant Burgers this spring in about 600 stores in the San Francisco Bay Area and Dallas-Fort Worth, but the daily sales were much lower than anticipated, and then they couldn't continue to sell because it didn't make economic sense. These burgers had to be cooked to order and on a drive-through where speed is of the essence, that would be a deal breaker.
Yeah, and the another reason is lack of versatility. Almost all plant-based meat companies started with ground beef or chicken nuggets or chicken tenders because they're easy to manufacture than simulating a steak or it says here, chicken breast.
Yeah, so it's... overall, it hasn't turned out to be the gold mine that people were anticipating.
No, the only thing that's really gained momentum would be those alternate milks, like the almond milk and coconut milk and things like that.
Yeah, and those
seem to be thriving. And I noticed they're used in some coffee shops for frappes.
Yeah, for lattes.
Lattes, yeah.
Yeah, the thing is that so many people have developed lactose intolerance and can't have cow's milk, as you pointed out, the European cows are the ones that don't have these irritants in them.
Yep.
But we don't have the European cows in this country pretty much. But I think, so basically what it comes down to is that we've talked on several different shows about the meat that is cultured from cells from real animals.
That's something that's gaining, it's gaining more momentum. And I think that's might be, at least it's still meat. Now, how you grow these things, I guess they're growing it with light, and how are they feeding these things?
Right now, as we've pointed out in the past couple of shows, it's extremely expensive, and it's high energy, so it isn't really saving the planet anything.
No.
But we'll see how it goes.
Yeah. So the next article is from a health magazine.
Healthista.com.
Yeah, 5 reasons a high protein diet is the key to fat loss. Now, some of this thing I agree with, but some of it I don't agree with.
Right, let's look at it. Mm-hmm.
So protein is often recommended by nutritionists to keep you feeling fuller for longer and to contribute to successful weight management. And the reason I have problems with this, because we're talking about comparing carbohydrates with protein. That's really not a fair comparison, because protein is the building blocks of everything we are, while carbohydrate is a fuel.
Right.
And the other fuel that we use often is fat. So if you're going to compare something, I would think that you would compare fat and carbohydrates. But fat has been so vilified over the years that nobody wants to really mention that, and especially saturated fat, which we know if you're buying it from a well-sourced animal source, then it's going to be very good for you. Heck, we use lard in just about everything that we cook.
I save the fat rendering from the bake when I make bacon and use that to cook the eggs in the morning and things like that.
Yeah, so let's go on. He says,
so it says, but I think let's just focus on why having a more protein is good for losing and keeping off excess weight.
Oh, it says here, you may have heard of the paleo and low carbohydrate diets, which have become popular over the years for their high protein intake. And again, that's kind of a misstatement, because it's moderate protein. The catchphrase
says higher.
Yeah, higher, but it's really not. It's actually a lot of times lower.
Well, it is.
What is higher is the fat.
Yeah, well, and it's lower because we don't have to eat as much of it.
Because you're satisfied. And why are you satisfied? And we'll get into that.
Okay, right. So reason number one. Protein reduces appetite and hunger. So it says protein keeps you feeling fuller for longer.
And actually what I think about this is this, the fat that goes along with the protein. And remember, if you just have a normal steak, the fat that's in there, even if you trim it, is about 50-50 with the protein. So you're eating half protein, half saturated fat.
If you
and
eat
other
the fat.
Well,
you have to eat the fat
because even if you trim it, it's still half and half.
Yeah,
it's the meat that we like that has the fat around it, the extra fat that we prize because it keeps us satisfied, right?
Yeah,
and this is kind of what they're alluding to, is that protein reduces appetite and hunger, but it's really the fat that does that.
Well, it's a combination of the two, and it's
in
very satisfying, and it says it's that. Eating the protein and feeling full, satisfied, will curb a too high calorie intake, therefore facilitating fat loss. Studies have shown that having a breakfast high in protein can help control hunger and may help curb your appetite later in the day. And they've also found that people who consumed extra protein at breakfast had lower blood sugar levels and reduced appetite later in the day compared to those consuming less protein.
So if you're starting with pancakes with syrup, or if you're
or cereal, or any grain toast,
and then, you know, with the cereal, you're going to have your low fat milk, right? Or maybe almond milk, which is lower in fat. So the whole thing is skewed to.
Well, we stopped eating the cereals for breakfast.
Yeah, many years ago.
Yeah, it's been quite a number of
years.
Yeah,
and then we just have bacon and eggs in the morning, or bacon and sausage sometimes.
So we'll cook. And you don't have to stand in front of the pan every single morning with bacon. You can cook bacon ahead of time on the weekend, for example, and then just put it in the fridge. And I put it in a Ziploc bag with a little paper towel around it. And then
really
I pull it out in the morning, put a few slices of bacon
and
on
just
breakfast.
Cook the eggs.
and cook the eggs, or you can throw the bacon back in the pan to warm it up a little bit while you're cooking the eggs. So it's not hard.
No. So reason number two is protein promotes muscle repair and growth. And this is exactly true. Nutrition plays an extremely important role in optimizing performance during and after exercise. Numerous studies have showed that increased muscle mass when consuming plenty of protein, for sure. And remember that if you eat too much protein, your body kind of stores it away as fat or converts it to a carbohydrate, so your brain gets the food it needs. Mm-hmm. So if you overeat protein, it can also make you fat. So I mean,
everything in moderation.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it says protein is made up of amino acids, which are essential building blocks for your body. You need them for vital processes such as building proteins, hormones, and neurotransmitters.
And the important part of this to remember is that amino acids, there's certain ones that your body doesn't make, and there's 9 of those called essential. Now, if your body doesn't make them and you don't get them, your body is trying to repair things. And because it doesn't have the right combination of amino acids, what happens is your body kind of throws it out. And it starts all over again.
So you're missing pieces, so get rid of all of it.
Exactly.
It doesn't pick and choose.
No, it doesn't.
Mm-hmm. Reason number three.
Protein supplies blood.
Supports
blood sugar balance.
Yeah, it's interesting that this paragraph talks about the fact that when they did all their studies to determine whether eating protein had any effect on blood sugar levels, they found it didn't. And it says glucogenesis is a process in which the body makes sugar through the liver. The building blocks of protein amino acids do not increase how fast sugar is released from the liver. Therefore, eating protein does not affect blood sugar levels.
No, it doesn't affect it. But what does affect it very well is fat, some good saturated fat or good combination.
It helps keep it low.
It keeps it low. So mm-hmm. instead of using carbohydrates for fuel, you're using fat for fuel if you're eating protein. So that's the real answer here. They don't mention much about fat in here at all.
So, no, but again, this is an article about protein. So,
yes.
So it says, additionally, the role of insulin has a positive impact when protein is ingested. Insulin helps amino acids and protein enter the body cells and influence muscle function.
Yeah. Here, reason number four, and this is a true statement, you burn more calories eating protein than any other macronutrients.
You know, the thermic effect of food, TEF, that's the burning of the food in your body. So it's, and it creates the energy. It's the caloric burning and it creates the energy.
Yeah, so it means that protein requires more energy to be processed in your body. Protein takes the most energy to digest. 20-30% of the calories in protein go to digesting. Next is carbohydrates, 5-10%, and then fat. So fat hardly takes any energy. Just think about that whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're eating some really good natural fat, mm-hmm. your body doesn't use much energy at all. And it gets absorbed just like that, and you have all the energy you need. The carbohydrates are there kind of as a booster in case mm-hmm. you need to run away from a predator
from a saber-toothed tiger.
Or from a politician, something like that. Yeah.
All
Number
right.
five.
Number five. Protein keeps you feeling fuller for longer. They had alluded to that a little bit earlier in the article. It says it takes longer to digest, and it gives your body the feeling of satiety, satisfaction.
And I would say the combination of the protein and the fat that goes along with mm-hmm. it is actually what gives you the satiety.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the protein does take you longer, so you're going to be satisfied more for sure.
Okay, and when you eat a higher amount of protein, it increases your the appetizing reducing hormones, GLP-1, peptide YY, and cholecystokinin, your hunger hormone. So if you're, by consuming enough protein, we naturally will consume less calories as we feel fuller for longer, which contributes to healthy weight management and fat loss.
Yeah. One of the other statements here is too much protein a thing? Yes, it's important to note that consuming too much protein can be potentially detrimental to the kidneys over a long period of time.
But again, you're not eating half a cow. You're eating smaller portions than you were eating before.
If you have the fat with it.
If you have the fat with it and you have the naturally sourced meats and the free range and the grass-fed and and so yeah. on.
So the next article is kind of related to this. It's called Low Protein Diet from Processed Foods Drives Overeating and is Fueling the Obesity Crisis.
Yeah, this is, again, we've talked about this, the high process, the overprocessed foods. This is the low protein content of highly processed foods like sodas, chips, and fast food can be key to understanding why there's a rising rate of obesity in the Western world.
Yeah, think about processed foods. They're low in protein usually. They're also low in fat, the two things that we want, and then they're high in carbohydrates.
And they're high in manufactured nutrients.
Yeah, so even the impossible meats and all these things that we've been talking about are in the same vein here. They're not going to be giving you the satisfaction you need, and that's why these low protein diets, and I would say low protein and low fat diets from processed foods, drives the overeating. So they're really missing this component. They kind of have just kind of stuck away from the fat completely and not giving people the right information.
The problem is when you say the word fat, it conjures up all kinds of strange and horrible
demons. Yeah, because you think if you eat fat, you're going to get fat.
Yeah, and in fact, if you eat good animal fat, it helps, it burns off and it helps you maintain and lose weight.
Sure. Yeah.
Fat burns fat.
Yeah.
So here are some key fat. This, by the way, is an article from Forbes magazine. And they talk about a study that was done in Australia with more than 9,300 Australians. The amount of protein eaten during the first day of the meal has a profound influence on
first
what
meal of the day.
What did I say? First day of the meal?
Yeah, that's okay. You correct okay. me a lot of time. I get you back now. Has
right.
a profound influence on what people went on to eat at different meals throughout the day.
Mm-hmm. And that was, okay, so it says those consuming higher levels of protein at the start of the day had lower overall energy intakes. Energy beyond what the body needs is stored often as fat. So throughout the day, compared to those who consume lower levels of protein during the first meal, the researchers found.
Yeah, those eating low levels of protein in the first meal ate more subsequent meals and tend to eat more energy-dense processed foods high in saturated fat. And here they're vilifying fat because if you're eating processed food, the fat in there is not any good.
It's not good. All right, so let's just...
And also, the sugar's not that good, the salt's not that good, and the alcohol.
People also end up taking more alcohol, they said. That's what the researchers found. So there's a whole discussion in here about obesity, and it's quite interesting, actually. It's a nice, succinct description of obesity. It says, obesity is defined as having excess weight, usually from fat, beyond what is considered healthy for a given height. And it is widely recognized one of the leading public health problems of the modern age. Beyond the strains excess weight can directly impose on the body, it is linked to shorter lifespan and a myriad of major health conditions and killers like heart disease, cancer, and diabetes. Obesity is known to impair the immune system and can make people more vulnerable to serious outcomes for a number of other diseases. More than one third of adults in the U.S. are obese, according to the CDC, which is more than 72 million people. That's just in the U.S.
Yeah, and that first statement that says obesity defined as having excess weight, usually from fat, that's true.
That means your body has got fat in it.
Right.
Not
the consuming
what you're taking
part.
In.
Right.
Even more are considered overweight, a lesser, though still unhealthy amount of excess weight, which is also associated with many health risks. The burden is not even across the United States. Some groups have a noticeably higher rate of obesity.
Yeah, certain
so
groups.
Obesity is a growing and significant problem among children, affecting 1 in 5.
And also minorities.
Well, yeah. I mean, I said it was...
Yeah. So surprising fact here, they say obesity is more than just a public health threat. It's also a threat to national security because military leaders and the CDC both warn that high levels of obesity and physical inactivity, particularly among the young adults, hampers the nation's ability to muster military might.
And it says only 2 in 5 young adults aged 17 to 24 are able to take part in basic trainings, according to the CDC. One in three are too heavy to serve. And then of those who are eligible, three in four report, only three in four, so three quarters of them report physical activity levels that would prepare them for basic training.
Yeah, this really applies to any sport. So if you're obese, you're muscle,
you can't,
you're not going to play baseball as much or football or go skating or do anything. So bringing the military into this is kind of like leaving out the whole fat thing too.
The point is, obesity is an epidemic in this country.
And, no doubt about it.
In fact, around the world. And it's significantly impairing people's ability to have a meaningful and comfortable life.
No doubt about it. And it's mostly the fault of advertising, I believe.
Well,
because you don't advertise good food.
Well, okay.
Okay, so the next article on that note, intermittent fasting linked to disorder eating.
Now, we've talked in past shows about intermittent fasting and the timed eating, you know.
Intermittent fasting.
No, but there's also, time-restricted eating.
Yeah.
So that you don't eat after a certain time and, you know, try and eat your dinner before. We've talked about all of that and that it is can be very beneficial to your health. And then now this article actually shines a light on eating disorders and how people take and pervert the concept of intermittent fasting.
Well, first of all, if you're going to do any type of fasting, intermittent fasting or restrictive eating, the first thing you have to be is healthy in the first place. So you're not going to use this for losing weight.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going to use this to binge later on. So you, first of all, you have to have all your faculties in order. This is something that our ancestors did and we're very, very good at, because if you're very, very hungry and you're starving, you still have to hunt, which means you have to be stealthy and smart and you have to outsmart the animal, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have to know what to gather if you're a vegetarian. And if your mind is going crazy like mine used to do 15, 20 years ago, when I used to get hungry, I used to just be nuts. And that was the whole thing about the carbohydrates and using carbohydrates. And all of a sudden, your blood sugar drops. And all of a sudden,
the crash.
You crash. And now you're getting ornery.
And then they created a new term for it called hangry.
So intermittent fasting, which is IF, has been popularized for its supposed health benefits, which are backed by some research. But new findings published in Eating Behaviors at the University of Toronto have linked this to eating disorders and potentially dangers and compulsive behaviors.
Well, so here's the thing. If you're talking about intermittent fasting, you might do the 16-8. You fast for 16 hours and you eat during an 8-hour window, or the 14-10, which is fast for 14 hours and eat between 10 hours. With the 10-hour window. I mean, when you say fast, it just means you don't eat during that time.
Yeah, so you have
breakfast.
8 o'clock, and then at 4 o'clock you eat a dinner, and then you don't eat again until breakfast.
O'clock.
Yeah, and that's what we've been doing for years.
Right, right.
So hasn't led to any behavior problems like vomiting or compulsive exercise.
But the point is, if you have an eating disorder,
you can take this
intermittent fasting and this time eating to a different level. And it says that we know that, according to this article, the dietary restraint and restrictions is a major risk factor for people with eating disorders.
Right.
So we hypothesize that intermittent fasting, which is a way, in many ways, a more regimented practice of dietary restrictions and restraints, would also be a major risk factor for eating disorders. So they found that the prevalence of intermittent fasting behaviors among adults and young adults was significant.
Yeah, findings indicate that 38% of men and 47% of women, and a little over half of the gender non-conforming or transgender individuals, reported practicing intermittent fasting in the past 12 months.
But they don't mention.
Well, it's been in the news, and that's why people want to try it, and they think it might be something to help them lose weight or fix their compulsive eating problem.
Fit in with their compulsive eating problem.
Exactly, yeah. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, but here's the thing they don't talk about. They talk about the intermittent fasting, but they don't talk about the pattern of eating in between the fasting periods. Mm-hmm. So that's where you run into trouble if you have an eating disorder.
Well, first of all, you have to have your blood sugar in order, because if you're going to eat something small, like bacon and eggs in the morning, mm-hmm. and then you don't eat for 8 hours or so, mm-hmm. then you probably will get hungry and your blood sugar is going to crash. So you first have to get that diabetes part of your whole system in order before you can start something like that. This is a very good system for regulating your body things, but not when you're having problems, I think.
Some studies have shown that intermittent fasting has benefits that include, and this is a quote, ameliorating gut hormone levels, specifically lowering insulin levels, which decreases our risk for insulin resistance and diabetes, decreased markers for inflammation, and decreased visceral fat. Yeah. But...
And they also say more rigorous studies are needed to validate these results. Okay. I think it's pretty much established this is the way our ancestors ate.
Well, it says here, according to this article, it says that this study, and this is a quote, this study points out that faddish behavioral practices like intermittent fasting that develop quickly and become reinforced through social media can produce unanticipated harmful effects.
No doubt about it.
Yeah, despite true of anything.
Yeah, for sure. Despite its popularity and purported health benefits, a new study found that intermittent fasting may lead to unhealthy and even dangerous behaviors in adolescents and young adults. It certainly could. People that have distorted self-images and compulsive behaviors, this is
are
not,
vulnerable.
Yeah, no doubt about it. But they're vulnerable to... But every it's not, kind of eating, right?
It's not the intermittent fasting fault.
No, it's definitely not mm-hmm. there. No. Mm-hmm.
But, you know, everything. Sometimes we have the unintended consequences or the militarization of a peaceful invention or, you know, things of that nature. And so ultimately everything can be turned around and abused if that's what's going on in a person's life. Yes. Right, from the sublime to the ridiculous.
Why do regular and organic milk taste different? And they certainly do. Consumers buy their preferred type of milk for a number of reasons, including for their health, for flavor, for price, and availability. Before a wider variety of milk alternatives were available, most people were simply deciding if they wanted full or non-fat. And in the 90s, another player entered the competition, which was organic milk. Well, organic milk naturally has been around for thousands of years. People have been milking cows
right.
and not doing anything to them and using it for a week or so, and then they get refreshed milk. And this is the way it's always
been.
Yeah,
well, here's the thing. Conventional dairy milk, the cows are treated with growth hormones, with antibiotics because of their living conditions. They tend to develop diseases and pass them on. And that all comes through in the milk. And then organic milk would be the free-range cows.
Yeah, they have stricter rules on what they can eat and how they graze compared to organically raised cows. So organic milk, on the other hand, has many more regulations surrounding it. Organic milk cannot be treated with any growth hormones or antibiotics, and their feed also has to be antibiotics. So no GMOs, those things. And they must be led to a graze in the pasture.
Yeah, well, the bottom line is that, you know, without feeding them food that is not their normal natural food.
Yeah, the main differences between organic milk and dairy milk is how they are pasteurized. It's also the reason why they taste a little bit different. So normal pasteurization means the product gets heated over a certain amount of time to a certain temperature.
165 degrees for 15 seconds. And that extends the milk shelf life to 2 weeks, because if you just put the dairy cow's milk up on the in the cooler, it would go bad because it's organic, you know. So they say that organic milk is pasteurized to 280 degrees, but for only 2 seconds. And this gives it a longer shelf life than regular milk.
And actually, if you take it right from the cow and bottle it up, it actually, if you don't refrigerate it, it can stay in that form for about a week to 10 days mm-hmm. before it goes bad. So the reason that we've pasteurized milk many, many years ago is because we travel so far distances, and also we put it in different kind of containers and things like that.
From the farm to your table.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So this is the reason the whole pasteurized things, if you actually have it.
If you have a cow in the backyard and you get your...
You don't need to pasteurize it. Right. You don't heat it, and that's probably the best thing. Mm-hmm. Although organic...
And it says the high heat... The key difference is what causes the types of milk to taste different. The high heat and the ultra-pasteurization of organic milk causes the sugars to crystallize and the proteins to denature. And the cooked sugars can be tasted in the organic milk and give it a slightly tan color.
Right.
And so, there are other, it's interesting in this article, there's a photo of the milk section. Mm-hmm. And it shows soy milk, and it shows almond milk, and it shows all kinds of different oat milk, and, so.
We don't really drink milk at all.
No.
And main reason is we don't have the A2 cow here. Mm-hmm. We have the A1 cow, and there's differences in it. And you're lactate intolerant.
Lactose intolerant for dairy cow. But it's interesting, though, that...
If you go to Europe and drink the milk there, you wouldn't be, probably.
Yeah, but what's interesting to me is that I can eat certain dairy. Well, first of all, I can eat all the goat milk cheeses, no problem. I don't have a problem with that. But I can also eat things like gelato, which is an Italian-style ice cream, mm-hmm. that for whatever reason does not affect me. It has to be the
cow.
The different cow.
Yeah. So mm-hmm. here's another cow. From the Washington Post, but I think I got it from Forbes also. So cow-fed hemp produced milk with THC.
The cows that were fed hemp produced milk that had THC in it. And THC, of course, is the
buzz-inducing molecular compound.
That's so what's in marijuana. Medical and recreational marijuana.
Yeah. Dairy cows showed behavioral changes too, yawning and salivating a lot and moving a little unsteady on their hooves, standing in one place.
For a protected period and having a somnolent appearance. In other words, like they were half asleep.
Yeah.
I wonder if they got the munchies.
Yeah, maybe so. They're eating a lot of grass out there. They're always eating though, aren't they? So use under U.S. law does not allow THC in the food chain, but the new research comes as hemp, which is used for many industrial uses.
It has been for centuries.
Yeah, continues to emerge from an agricultural exile that dates back to the Reefer Madness film.
Hysteria of 1930s. Yeah. Well, so, hemp is the common name of the plant Cannabis sativa, and humans have cultivated it for thousands of years. Its fibers are prized in rope manufacturing. It's also used in clothing manufacturing. George Washington grew it at Mount Vernon in the late 1700s. And in the recent years, the Mount Vernon estate has been growing it again.
Yeah. Of course, the highest concentration of the THC is in the flowers, which is the top of the plants. When you use it for rope and things like that, you're using more of the stems and things like that.
Well, and by the way, THC is technically known as Delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol.
Yeah. It's not...
Benol.
So...
No wonder they call it
one of the things that comes to mind, why the heck are they feeding cows hemp in the first place?
That's a good question.
You know, why aren't they feeding them grass? It's the same question I asked. Why are they feeding them corn? Because if you put a cow out the pasture, he's probably not going to go for the corn. He's going to go for the grass and the greenest mm-hmm. grass. Maybe if there's nothing else, he'll go for the corn. But that's...
Sheil. Industrial hemp is not the pot plant cultivated by people hoping to grow their own weed. Under the Farm Bill of 2018, industrial hemp is no longer listed as a controlled substance so long as it contains no more than 0.3% THC. But one byproduct of that change in the law is the booming market for another hemp-derived molecular
CBDs.
Compound, which is CBD.
That's right.
And that's typically marketed for health benefits. You can get a dose of it in your coffee if you go to the right cafe.
Yeah.
And the claimed health benefits of CBD D, for the most part, are not approved by the Food and Drug Administration, and the FDA has approved only a few products derived from hemp and has sent warning letters to some companies making scientifically hazy claims about CBD products.
They say, of course, they're pushing the hemp. It's right now they're stating here, and this is a quote, it's not going to be such a really large market. There's actually animal feed shortages in this country right now. So ramifications of what's happening in Ukraine and the droughts and other crop failures. Mm-hmm. So this is maybe why they're turning to hemp as a substitute. But again,
the dairy industry will likely want to use hemp as a feed additive if it gets federal approval and is competitive with other sources of protein, said Jamie Jonker, chief science officer at the National Milk Producers Federation. The industry, he said, has struggled with the rising costs of feed and energy, though some of that pressure has been relieved by high prices on milk.
Yep. Another possible use of hemp in livestock is a stress reducer. For example, when cows are being transported, it's a good idea maybe to give them a little hemp and then they're going to feel a little bit better.
They feel calmer.
But they will be hungry when they get off that shuttle. Right?
Well, the Kansas State University assistant professor Michael Kleinhen says, we don't know if they have a buzz or whatnot, but they do have lower levels of stress hormones. The cannabinoids reduce stress, he thinks, but we still have to figure out that mechanism in animals.
It's not like you can ask them.
I was just thinking that. Excuse me, how do you feel? All right.
So I guess that's enough of that, but it's kind of funny. I found that amusing.
I really liked the part where they described how the cows were standing in one place for a protected period and a little unsteady on their hooves.
So this is an article here about anti-aging supplement, and we do take some anti-aging supplements
that are
mentioned in here.
Yeah,
but this particular one is called
nicotinamide
riboside. Riboside. Mm-hmm. It's a form of B3. Is advertised as anti-aging effects as well as being able to bring down high cholesterol and blood pressure. Of course, we started using NAD+, which is a formula that NR makes in your body after you digest it. Mm-hmm. Now, we had been following Dr. David Sinclair, mm-hmm. who'd been doing research on this for many years, about maybe 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. And he said, don't take the NR, take the NAD+. And this may be one of the reasons for that is because of the way the body processes NR, it leads to growth in certain things.
Cancers.
Yeah, so it can be in cancers.
It can. So that's, again, you know, you take a good look at the research and see what it recommends. And there are lots of products out there. And again, we take the product that's the next in line.
Yeah, the NAD+. The NR is less expensive, and this may be the reason why a lot of people are taking it. But there has been some research on this. They say here some people take them, the vitamins and supplements, because they automatically assume the vitamins and supplements have positive health benefits, but little is known how they actually work. So this supplement industry is booming in the United States right now with more half the population of the United States.
Well, the boomers are all getting older and they're doing it kicking and screaming. They're looking for those anti-aging vitamins and supplements.
Yeah.
So just do your homework on that one.
So they did research with mice with cancers, and they were injected with this NR and then photographed with special lights, sensors, cameras, and they monitored their cancer cells, the T cells, which are the type of white blood cells, and they looked at the healthy tissues. And NR increased the spread of cancer cells to the brain in 9 out of 11 mice compared to only 3 of the 12 mice in the control group not given the supplement.
Yeah, so the bottom line is that it's really important if you're going to take any kind of supplements or any kind of regimens that you really do look into them carefully before you put them into your body.
Yeah, I would look at Dr. Sinclair and some of his talks on YouTube. And what I'll do is I'll look for one of the talks that we listen to and put it in the show notes so people can look at that. And I think that's going to be good education for you. And you just have to be careful with some of these supplements and the claims that they make. So do your own research is what we always say, right?
Okay,
here's an interesting article. The unexpected ancient origins of restaurant menus.
Yeah, so...
Well, first of all, you have to have a restaurant. And when do restaurants were...
I think they're talking about menus in general. Food menus. Okay, choices of what you can eat. So it says, the history of restaurant menus is in many ways simply a history of innovation and change. And they go right to QR codes. Which is like so new. It says the technology for QR codes was created in Japan during the 1990s, according to the New York Times. But they were not commonly used in the U.S. restaurants before. Until around 2020, which is very recently.
And that's because of that whole thing, right?
Although initially added as a safety measure, restaurants came to appreciate the many benefits of QR codes, which include digital payments, tracking the sales of menu items, monitoring the preferences of individual customers. But then, now let's go back before QR codes, which are really new. Restaurant menus were changing and evolving. During the 1990s, desktop publishing software was introduced. So then you could change a menu every week if you wanted to, because you could just pop it right out of the computer printer. And for the first time, they were able to add new menu items and specials. And the new menu freedom unleashed a flurry of creativity from chefs and restaurateurs in terms of how menus were written and formatted.
Yeah, the history of evolution and changes go all the way back to the first restaurant menu, which was written on a stone tablet.
Yeah, the first menu that is still in existence, the oldest, let's say. The oldest menu is a stone tablet from a party that was thrown by an Assyrian king 3,000 years ago. The king invited about 70,000 people to his epic bash in 879 BC.
Were they all scrambling for that tablet? I mean,
here's the thing. The bash lasted for a week and a half.
Ah.
And the tablet, which is now known as the banquet stele, features a description of what was being served. It was not a choice. It wasn't a menu of choices.
Yeah.
But the first true restaurant menus probably originated in China during the early 12th century Song Dynasty.
Yeah, the innovation grew out of travel between cities in China since the regional dishes offered in each locale, eateries were largely unknown to the visitors.
So menus were born, and in the beginning they were visual. They showed you pictures, or they displayed the dishes. So maybe, no,
put
I don't
on
think
a big
that,
table. Was,
yeah, on a big table, yeah. Said these are your choices.
Kind of
right?
Think Thanksgiving. Want to look at my menu? Here's my table.
Come over here and choose what you want. Like a buffet.
Yeah.
So, then menus soon evolved into a recognizable format. In Jacques Journet's book, Daily Life
in China on the Eve of the Mongol Invasion.
Yeah, which was by the 13th century, there were taverns where a menu was handed to customers from which they could choose their dishes that they wanted.
Western menus, meanwhile, evolved contemporaneously.
How many letters in that word? Holy
a lot of them. And with the development of French restaurants in the late 18th centuries, per the magazine called Mental Floss, the first restaurant menus in the U.S. were offered at Delmonico's in New York City. Historic evidence confirms their use in the iconic restaurants by the 1830s.
That's cool. All right.
Here we go for the last one. I thought this was kind of an interesting thing. There's a little kitty cat here pictured. Meet the rare gender-neutral kitten with no sex organs.
Yeah, the poor cat was born with no sex organs.
Well, he doesn't know any better. Or she, or it.
Or they. This article actually keeps referring to the cat as they, which is the current term for a gender neutral term.
Yeah, well, this is probably the only true gender neutral.
All right.
Because
let's not get into discussions on.
Well, I'm just saying that this is the only true way. So either you have the male sex hormones, the female sex hormones,
sex
or
organs,
you don't have any.
Organs.
Or sometimes you have two.
Yeah, there's a charity in the United Kingdom, in the UK, that specializes in cats. It's called Cats Protection. It's a rescue center. And they did find, previously they had found one kitten that was a hermaphrodite, meaning they had both sets of sex organs.
Right.
But this one is called, has a rare condition called agenesis, which is the absence or failure of organ development. So they had never seen a cat with that situation, and they had also not found any documentation of a cat born without sexual organs in any of the scientific literature.
And this has led veterinarians to think that Hope, which is the name of the cat, made the world's first documented case of a gender-neutral cat.
Yeah, she was adopted. The cat was adopted and is alive and well and thriving and doesn't seem to have any,
doesn't have any problems, that's
for sure. It's interesting, yeah, because apparently the cat seems able to engage in bodily functions without any problem.
That was the first thing they kind of worried about.
Well, except, the bladder is a separate...
Yeah. But if there's no opening there, so apparently there is some kind of opening.
Yeah,
there
right, exactly. It's just that the sex organs are gone.
Right. Cute little thing.
Yeah, beautiful little cat.
Yeah. Anyway, it's an interesting article, and it just brought to mind all the gender things that are happening now in our society that, it's confusing to me that, people have to make up their own mind what they want to be called, I guess.
Yeah,
but now there's 60 or 70 different terms, and it seems
I don't really care. Because
no, I don't either. But some people get offended if you don't call them that, if
you
don't
know
it.
You know, I have always taken the position that a person's name is very personal.
Right.
And if your name is Michael and you don't want to be called Mike or Mick or some other name, I always ask a person, what's your preference? What do you like to be called? And when they say to me, well, whatever, call me whatever you want, I say, please tell me what you like to be called.
Yeah.
So I don't use diminutives. I don't use nicknames unless a person tells me that's the name they prefer. So fine. So maybe do I have to now add what pronoun would you like me to use? And I mean, that's basically where we are with this. And
my dad always said, I don't care what you call me, as long as you call me.
Yeah.
But he had a sixth sense of humor. Yeah, it's a fascinating thing. I know in nature there are homosexual animals.
Yeah, but there's only two sexes.
But there is only two sexes, and that's the thing. But now we have the ability through surgeries to change your sex if that's what you want. And that's a big, talk about a step that you're going to take. I mean, that's a huge one. And I would think it's hard to go back. It's probably even harder, right?
Well, I think what we've got here is a combination. It's a very, very complicated process. The whole, from everything from how you choose to live your life, to the way you feel, to your mental state, to the hormones, to the enzymes. There's just so much that is absolutely fundamental to your body health that is linked to the enzymes and the hormones. And so it's not a simple situation. And it's, frankly, everybody should just decide,
Well, the other thing, too, is like...
Be who you want to be.
Our indigenous people in America here had a special designation for people who were homosexual, and they called them very special.
And this is not what we're talking
about.
No,
I'm just thinking that what has created this whole thing, and I think it's the way we modern humans communicate with our social media and everything, and the importance of having your name and the likes and things like that. So now if you want to be special and you just feel kind of normal, maybe you're going to tend to one extreme or the other extreme. I don't know, but it was a real minority of people that I knew when I was a teenager that were a gender other than male or female, right? That's the way I saw it. In other words, I knew one gay guy. I never knew anybody.
That had nothing to do with his gender. He was still male.
You know, but still, he identified more as a female.
No, he didn't. He identified as a male who preferred males.
Yeah, I guess so. Well, I guess that's right.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, you know, it's...
I'm all confused.
Who you're attracted to is it's hormonal, it's chemical, it has to do with pheromones. And it is what it is, and so what, you know?
Well, yeah, I don't care. Yeah, sure. It's just an interesting thing that's happening. It's just becoming more and more in front of your face.
Well, it doesn't have to. I mean, basically, I mind my own business, and whatever a person chooses to do, they choose to do.
It's fine with me, yeah.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
That's all. It's, I guess. You know, diversity is the buzzword for the century right now, for the decade. And, you know, whatever. People need to get over themselves and stop having judgments about everything. And,
yeah.
And let people live the life they choose to live. As long as they're not hurting anybody, they're not disrupting society, they're not running around robbing banks or anything like that. I mean, you know, live your life. Leave them alone.
That's a good way to end the show, I guess. Thanks for sticking around, folks. I hope we haven't confused anybody, but we'll see you next time.
Be well.
Bye-bye.